Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in North Carolina. I started to say Philippines again. What can I do? God bless you guys. I'm working on two different messages that the Lord gave me for Moses, in reference to Moses, as I mentioned in a video the other day, and a couple people were asking me about it. They're interested in that, and I got two different messages, so if the Lord leads me to give out one today, I will. I'm also got a list of people that's looking for a word from the Lord that I will do. I think that's number 14. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. I just want to say that I know that God is our provider, brothers and sisters. Those of you who are familiar with Joshua's ministry are know, if you're in the ministry, most of you are not, but if you know someone who is in the ministry that's a missionary and all the kind of stuff like what the Lord has allowed me to do for him, there's faith and walking by faith and doing the will of God in faith that is most people don't, you know, go to. The Bible says to every man is dealt the measure of faith, and then there's the gift of faith, and the gift of faith particularly is usually used the example of God telling you, oh, go pray for that person, I'm going to raise him from the dead, something like that, an unusual act that requires special faith, usually associated with raising the dead. And that's the best example where you see this in operation, where, as a matter of fact, like down in Florida, I think it was in Miami, there was a cardiologist who was like a Baptist. He had a patient that died. He was pronounced dead. Lots of doctors and nurses were there. And this was on 700 Club, and I believe it was on, it was even like on ABC News and all kinds of stuff. It was on the national news. And I believe I was in the Philippines at the time, or I think so. So it was around 2007, 2008. Anyway, this cardiologist, you know, he had a patient that died. And then the Lord said to him, you know, and this guy's like not never really hearing from the Lord either, you know. He's not big on hearing from the Lord too much. And the Lord said, go, you know, pray for this guy, lay hands on him, I'm going to raise him from the dead. And he went back there and did it, and the guy was raised from the dead. You know, and it made the national news and everything. That's an example of the supernatural gift of faith. Also an operation with a gift of healing. And it's also, you know, you can, all the gifts kind of interlace because it was like a word of wisdom also. A word of knowledge is, why am I getting into these gifts of the Spirit? A word of knowledge is like the Lord tells you something like Ananias in the book of Acts when he was supposed to pray for Paul to be healed of his blindness. The Lord called to this Ananias and said, you know, there's a one of my servants named Saul of Tarsus, who is in a street called Straight. You know, go there, and there's still a street called Straight in Damascus today. And he said, go there and lay hands on him. And so the word of knowledge was is that he heard that the Lord told him that Saul was there and that he was waiting for him, Ananias, to come pray for him that he might receive his sight. So the only way he knew that this current event was going on was because the Lord gave me a word of knowledge. Hey, Saul is on a street called Straight, and he's blinded, and I want you to, you know, and I want you to go there and pray for him. Now, the word of wisdom is the second part I was just getting into. I want you to pray for him, and then I'm going to show him the great things he's supposed to suffer for me and all that. So the word of wisdom was what was going to happen in the future. A word of knowledge is something that's going on now. As an example, if I pray, give someone a word, and the Lord tells me, hey, this person has back pain. You know, and then I'll say to you, oh, the Lord is telling me you have back pain. That's a word of knowledge. A word of wisdom is God's going to heal you from the back pain, or God's going to use this to, you know, God has used this situation in your life to make you into the person he wants you to be, or something like that, and then the Lord's going to heal you. Something like that. Future event and what to do with the knowledge. Wisdom is the application of knowledge. I don't know why I'm getting into these gifts of the Spirit, but I really wanted to talk about faith. Okay, brothers and sisters. So, what I want to tell you guys know I came to the States walking by faith. I'm not even 100% sure where we're going to live. And every time I try to get all focused and say, I'm going to do ABC and then wait on, you know, because I haven't heard from the Lord, I'm trying to push forward with ABC, then something moves against that. You know, the Lord is not allowing that. So, you know, I have complete trust and faith in the Lord, brothers and sisters. And I say these things that it will be an example to you, brothers and sisters. And like I said, it's always amazing, and not you guys who probably watch this video. If I titled this, as I always say, if I titled this something about the rapture, of course, all those people who are waiting on the Lord but not working for the Lord would watch the video. But most of you guys who watch this video, if I put like a a non-rapture or tribulation or some kind of gossip or attacking someone, calling them a false prophet or something like that, some exaggerated news story, the people who would watch this already know what I'm talking about, and they're already pretty mature in the Lord. They desire to be mature in the Lord and have a humble spirit. So God bless all you guys. As King David said, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord than dwell in the tents of the wicked. So in other words, in modern way of saying, he said, you know, he'd rather be a servant for the Lord than to be, you know, some big shot among the evil people of the world. And brothers and sisters, that's being humble. And the Bible says God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. So, brothers and sisters, I'm asking, you know, and the Lord is leading me. I don't even care. I'm serious. If any of you guys know, which lots of you guys don't know, the amount of faith it takes to go be a missionary somewhere in a third world country, in a foreign land, you know, just to go somewhere, all of the details that are required to do that. You know, when you start getting involved and tied up in the details, the devil's in the detail, as they say. You know, the devil wants to get you caught up in all the details. So that's really ties back to what I want to talk about. One thing about Moses, one of the messages that the Lord gave me about Moses, the other one is, you know, getting the wicked people out of the camp. But the other one, that the first one that the Lord had given me, was, you know, talking about, I mentioned this in the video the other day, how Moses, when the Lord said, hey, I want you to go, you know, deliver my people. I've heard the cry of the people. I'm going to send you there to deliver them, Pharaoh. I'm going to harden Pharaoh's heart and all this stuff. And then Moses is like, well, you know, hey, I'm not a good speaker. And I made this comment the other day. It's really true. The biggest lesson of that, or one of the lessons, and a big one for us, is personal application. Moses was looking at himself and what he could do instead of looking to what God can do, because the Bible says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So, you know, God is the one doing it, not me or you. So that's the biggest lesson we can learn from Moses' error. You know, we can glean. I mean, that's what the Bible's for, as it says in the New Testament. All those things in the Old Testament are an example for us to learn the do's and don'ts and all that from the Bible. So this is a don't. Don't look at yourself, but look to the Lord. You know, the Bible is a mirror, as I mentioned many times in James. It tells us the Bible is a mirror. When we read the Word of God, it's just a man beholding himself in the mirror. Now, we look in the mirror of the Word of God to improve ourselves. You know, when we hold up, well, you know, God says that, you know, how can bitter water and sweet water come from the same spring? You know, in other words, saying bad words and cursing and cussing and all this out of your mouth, and at the same time, you know, trying to speak blessings. That's what James is referring to as an example of the mirror of God's Word. But when God says, hey, I want you to go be a missionary in the Philippines, we don't say, well, I've never been to the Philippines. I can't speak the different dialects there. You know, I don't have the money to do it. I don't know where to go, where to begin, and what to do. See, that's looking at yourself. So that's kind of like what Moses was saying. Okay, so very few of you guys, from your own experience, can appreciate what I'm trying to tell you. But there's huge, huge, huge things in the flesh that you have to deal with. But when I went to the Philippines, as they say, as my mom always likes to say, ignorance is bliss. And she always used that in reference to the fact that her and my dad got married at like 18 years old, straight out of high school. Ignorance is bliss. You know, they didn't know, you know, that they didn't have money. They didn't know how difficult it was going to be and all that kind of stuff. So that's normal. So when I went to the Philippines, even though I'd already been in the ministry for 5 or 6 years, 5 years, 7 years. Anyway, ignorance is bliss. I didn't know all those things, you know, all the difficulties and all that. If I'd have known all the difficulties that would happen in the flesh, I wouldn't have done it. So just like Joseph, when he had his dream of his brothers and his parents bowing down to him, he didn't know that A, he was going to be sold into slavery, B, he would be falsely accused of rape, and then, you know, go to be a prisoner, be a slave, then be falsely accused of rape, put into prison, and then finally, after 20 years or 21 years, he's exalted to the right hand of Pharaoh and becomes, you know, the second only to the Pharaoh, the vicar of Egypt, the viceroy of Egypt. So he didn't know that. If he'd have known that, of course, he would have been, you know, in the dumps. That's how God is. God will show you the mountaintop, and he usually doesn't show you the valley. God will. So not to be negative, and I've said this before, but when God starts showing you a mountaintop, not to think negatively, but think, You know, God has shown me this, and you need to keep that image, not the vain, your vain imaginations, but the imagination that God gave you. Hey, my brothers and sisters will bow down to me like Joseph. You keep that image that God gave you, that dream, that vision that God gave you in your mind, and you know that you're going to that mountaintop. But brothers and sisters, in all maturity, in all honesty, okay, whenever God tells you something, usually you will, next thing you will see, because lots of times there's very few of you guys are spiritual minded. Most of you are carnal minded. As an example, you know, if I gave a word, if the Lord gave me a word and I make that video, like in other words, if I said, well, the Lord showed me, and if it's really from the Lord, you know, sometimes we have dreams, it's, lots of times people have dreams, it's not from the Lord. Let's just say I had a dream or a vision and I said, the Lord said there's going to be a nuclear war in Korean Peninsula. And then the next day, they say, oh, we're going to make a peace deal. We're going to have a peace deal and do away with their nuclear arms. Everything's cool. Now, that is typical of what you see. Now, to use that in a different, whole different kind of an example. But that's true. If you said, the Lord told you that you're going to be able to go to the Philippines and be a missionary, and God's going to provide the finances and the sponsors and the prayer warriors, and he's going to lead you where to go, what to do, and all that, and everything's going to be all cool, and you go telling people that and praising God for it because of this dream or vision you had. The next day, you know, you get fired. You lose your job. You find out you're sick. That's how things happen. God tells you and gives you the end mountaintop or the next hilltop so that you will have your eyes of faith on that. And I should have really just done a whole video on this. I should chop this video, but because this is the Lord is leading me to some good wisdom here. You know, it's the because you talk about without faith it's possible to please him and all this. Faith in what? You know, just general concepts. We're not talking about salvation. The problem and the sad part with most people, they get saved, they bury their talents, and they live the rest of their life for themselves, as I keep mentioning about joy. They just keep going for themselves. Maybe their relatives, they try to evangelize them, pray for them, talk to them, and that's it. They don't go into the strangers, to the maimed, the halt, the weak. People who cannot repay them, people that are in like a third world country like the Philippines, they never get to that level, much less go to the Lord and putting everything about the Lord as first in everything in their life. So very few people get there because of lack of faith. You got the wrong vision, the wrong image in your mind. You have a vain imagination instead of the Lord's imagination that he wants to give you. So what am I trying to say? I'm trying to, you know, the Lord always gives me these breakdown one-liners that are easy to remember. You know, the Bible says, if our man's ways are pleasing to the Lord, he will give them the desires of his heart. God will give you the desires of your heart. But these prosperity people and these selfish, old denominational people too, they say, oh, if I'm doing good, God's going to give me the desires of my heart. But they're thinking that God's going to, you know, give me the, you know, the house that I want. But what it's, think of it this way. God is saying that I will give you the desires of your heart. God will give you the desires. Instead of saying, you know, I desire to have the biggest house in North Carolina to prove that God's a great provider. But God will give you the desire to say, hey, I want to sell everything I've got, give it to the poor, move to the Philippines, have a ministry in the Philippines. And I keep mentioning that because that's where I've been. Africa, wherever. And that's the desire of my heart that God gave me. The image in my mind, I see myself, you know, having 1,000 orphanages all over the third world, all over Africa, all over Asia, whatever. Whatever God would show you as that image. That's what you have faith in. Of course you have faith in the Lord. We already know that. You already say we need, you know, as it says in Hebrews 6, we need to move on from baby milk. We need to move on. From, you know, salvation and baptism and all these doctrines that for newborns, you know, and I've said this before, and I don't care if I had zero, you know, I don't care if I have no viewers. The only thing I care about, of course, is maintaining the orphanages and doing the will of God. You know, that's the only thing that I would say about if everybody got mad at me and didn't watch my videos or didn't, you know, care about the orphanages and stuff, I'd have to shut it down. But it's up to the Lord. That's up to the Lord. It's his kingdom. It's his orphanages, not mine. And I know the Lord will provide. If he wants them to continue, he'll provide. So that being said, brothers and sisters, you know, the Lord is the object of our faith. We know that. We're not talking about salvation. We're not talking about baptism. We're not talking about these elementary newborn in Christ things, you know, that we go back and keep repeating and repeating and repeating. Now, most people, like I said, I don't care if people get mad. The only reason why I paused is because I couldn't remember what I was going to say. Not that I'm worried about offending people. Most of the questions that people put their mind to, brothers and sisters, this is the truth. It's all of these detailed doctrinal ideas. To spend their whole relationship with the Lord is not even personally knowing Jesus, but all of this doctrine. I mean, that's the difference, really. Let's just say it this way. It's not always true, but generally, that's the difference between your Baptist and your Spirit-filled. Now, I don't say people that go to Assemblies of God and Church of God and all that. I'm talking about people who's been baptized in the Holy Spirit with evidence of speaking in tongues. The difference between a spiritual-minded person and a carnal-minded Christian and a spiritual-minded Christian is the things out of the mouth of the carnal-minded Christian is always debating, endlessly debating and supporting and defending and attacking doctrines. It's all doctrines. You know, my favorite, world-minded, you know, apologist, they call it. Someone is apologist who defends the faith. Ravi Zacharias, a brilliant man in the wisdom of man. You know, and he made this quote the other day, because now that I'm in the States, I've been trying to listen, because I love Ravi Zacharias, because I would use that information to deal with atheists, not to talk to Christians. But he made this statement, and I can't see if I get the quote right, but he said that, you know, doctrinal debates is to destroy lies. You know, intellectual debates, like what Dynamite, like Baptist, and all of those guys do, and all of this, and right and liberal of that, left of that, all the way to Roman Catholicism. It's all this mental debates. Those debates are used, and arguments and all this doctrine is to dispel lies. So in other words, and he said it in a way that I've said it, but I mean he said it in a succinct way better than the way I say it. But the way I've been saying it is, and he really summed it up great, and I can't think of the exact quote, but when you deal with atheists, like I have a brother that's an atheist and now he's agnostic and maybe even he believes in a creator, but you know, he's a little bit more than agnostic, but he's not a Christian. He don't know about Jesus, but he knows that there's obviously some kind of intelligent design. Okay, so those intellectual debates we use to dispel the lie, and that was all through intellectual debates. So all of that deep doctrine stuff you need only to open the mind, to break the lie off the mind of people that think they're so smart in this world about evolution and all of this kind of philosophical stuff and all this philosophy, you know, that there's God is dead and all this stuff, like Nietzsche said, all these things. That's what that information for. It's only to knock off the lie that their mind will be open to this experiential part of knowing God. And in his story that Ravi Zacharias told, he told about a man whose father was a famous apologist, and I can't remember his name, a famous guy like Ravi Zacharias in the last generation. And his son became a rebellious atheist, okay? And his dad was like the Ravi Zacharias of the 1930s and 40s and stuff like that. And this son, his dad was already dead for a long time, and he finally came back to the Lord. And when his mother died, he wrote in the Huffington Post, so this is pretty recent, he said, "I came back to Jesus because of the tender, gentle, non-judgmental, daily, unconditional love that my mother gave me." Something like that. Not all of the intellectual arguments and great wisdom and stuff that my father had, but in my experience with the unconditional Christ, the love of Christ, as shown through my mother's unconditional patient love toward me. So all of those people, like John MacArthur, who's a Holy Spirit blasphemer, and all of those guys who keep talking about, oh, we don't rely on experience. We only rely on the Word. Brothers and sisters, without the Holy Spirit, the Bible is just words. Any book is just words. But it's the Spirit that gives life. It's experience with God. When you're saved, you have a personal experience with God. when you have a vision or a dream and God says, you know, if you haven't had a dream or a vision, you know, if you don't have an imagination, an image, God's imagination, God is the greatest imaginer. God, you know, I'm really starting to preach and I always make a long sermon. I should put it all in separate videos so more people can appreciate and enjoy the wisdom that God gave me. Thank you, Lord. God is the one who imagined this creation. God is the one who imagined me and you. God is the one who imagined the roses and the mountains, you know, purple mountains' majesty and waves of grain, purple waves of grain and you know, from sea to shining sea and all of those things. God imagined the United States. God imagined all the beautiful places in Europe, in Germany and Italy and all of those beautiful Greek islands, all of those things. God imagined those things. God imagined, you know, even the oil that's under the ground that we turn around and use to make our cars go. God imagined that we would be saved, that we'd be lost and need to be saved. God already knew that from the beginning. God has got the greatest imagination. Okay? And God has to give, you have to receive. Let me tell you about it. God is already given. It's just like people that want to be saved. Jesus doesn't get back on the cross every time someone needs to get saved. Jesus, God doesn't give the Holy Spirit again. He gave the Holy Spirit once to the church, available to all Christians who are born again on the day of Pentecost. We have to receive, as Paul said to the Ephesian brethren there at Acts chapter 19, have ye received the Holy Spirit since you believed? They were already saved, sealed with the Holy Spirit, but they had not received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the filling of the Holy Spirit. So God is the one who gave us these things. He's given you a purpose. The Bible says, whom he foreknew, he predestined. So if you're saved, God has predestined a destiny for you. So the big question is why don't you know your destiny? Why don't you know God's imagination for you, that you might fulfill God's calling in your life, that the fullness of God might be complete in you? That's the question. Why have you not received the dream, the vision that God has for you? That's the question. God has a mission and a vision for every Christian. He's predestined us to be conformed to the image of Christ. And there's a process. In that process, like me, God used me to plant these orphanages, to plant these churches in the Philippines and in the United States. And then whatever the Lord would allow me to do before he returns, before the rapture, in this time period right now. How many years, days, months? I don't know. It's up to the Lord Jesus Christ. But he also has a mission for you. Very few people that I meet are walking in the will of God. Very few. Less than 10% of the people I know are walking in the will of God. Brothers and sisters, if you will get in the will of God, that's where your provision is. That's where your peace is. That's where your joy is, when you're walking in the will of God. I've been trying to nail down this message, as I always do, as the Lord leads me. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I thank you for watching this video, and I've got a whole lot more to say, and I just want to put this out there. I know God will provide for you when you are trying to walk in the vision that God gave you. And I ask you to receive the vision or dream that God will give you. I pray right now in the name of Jesus Christ that God will release. I take that back. See, I'm praying against my own teaching that I told you. I pray to God that you will receive, the dream and or vision that God has for you, that you will receive the imagination of God for you, for your destiny, that you can do what God called you to do. Brothers and sisters, I pray it right now that the Spirit of the Lord would overtake you and lead you captive into victory. Captive, as the Bible says, Jesus led captivity captive. I pray that you'll become captive by the Lord Jesus Christ, and that your imaginations will be captive to the Word of God and to the Spirit of God. Right now, I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Brothers and sisters, I ask for your personal prayer for me. You know, I got kind of a monkey wrench cast into the gears because I was not planning that I would have to buy a vehicle this fast. But the vehicle that a sister was nice enough to loan me, I have to give it back. You know, I wasn't planning on that. But as I was saying in the beginning of this video, whenever you're serving the Lord and you're trying to do the ministry and you're walking by faith, you know, I have 1,000 different things going on in the natural world. You know, the orphanages and the feeding programs and the pastors I deal with, and in the Philippines, and then the YouTube ministry, and the people that are asking me for a word, and the people who I'm praying for, and the people that I communicate with, and the Facebook, and then and all of those things that I'm doing for the Lord. It's like, it's all by faith, brothers and sisters. The Lord is doing it. I'm not building my own kingdom and not building my own denomination. I'm trying to do the Lord's will and walk totally by faith. And as I say, ignorance is bliss when you don't know about these things or you don't get your mind on them. So as an example, about getting a vehicle, I knew the day would come when I need to get a vehicle, but I didn't put my mind on, sit around fretting about it. I'm walking by faith. I know God will provide, and I know God will provide. Brothers and sisters, that's why I asked you to pray for me on all of the needs of the ministry, but particularly right now, whenever I was, you know, something in the natural bubbles up that I have to deal with immediately, then I have to deal with it. But other than that, I'm walking by faith, and I know God will provide, and you can't get into all the details, or you never get anything done. If you start fretting and worrying about all the little details, you're not walking by faith, but you're walking by sight, and you'll be fretting and out of faith and nervous and worried, and you won't be able to sleep, and, you know, you have high blood pressure and all that stuff. So I walk by faith, but if this is bubbling up, that I must face it and deal with it. I, you know, in the flesh, if I don't have a good vehicle, you know, before there was a brother in Pennsylvania and Pittsburgh who wanted to let me borrow an old car, and it broke down before I got there. Thank the Lord, it was a blessing from God that it broke down before I got there, the week before I got there. Last time I came in last August, if you guys remember. You know, I even flew to Pittsburgh to borrow that car, and then thank the Lord that, like I said, the week before I got there, the car broke down. Not after I got in it with my two-year-old, without AAA or anything, getting on the road, because I just landed in the States and then the car broke down. My wife's first time to the country with my two-year-old and the car broke down. So thank God it broke down. And then there's a sister who let me borrow this van that I've been borrowing when I've been coming to the States. It's like 2012 van. So it's reliable. But if I don't have a reliable car, and I know God can make a way and all that stuff about the vehicle, okay? But I'm not going to stand out here and have a 20-year-old clunker that's breaking down and laying hands on it and praying and just, you know, just going by faith that I can just make it from point A to point B. All the faith and the energy and all the drain to do that, to drive an old raggedy broken down car to try to get from point A to point B, would take too much of my RAM, my random access memory. My heart and mind would be too tied up worrying about getting from point A to point B and being broken down in the middle of the night with my three-year-old son and my wife in the middle of nowhere to be effective to do the ministry. So I know that God will provide and make a way that I can get a good enough car that I can say, hey, I'm not, you know, having to, you know, lay hands on it and speak in tongues for an hour, that the car will make it to across the street. So brothers and sisters, God bless you, and I know God will provide. But, you know, if I have a delay in getting a vehicle, I'm not going to be able to go around to these places. And those of you who have already made commitments to see, for sure, West Virginia, and then a big maybe for Akron. I'm waiting to hear from more people from the Akron, Ohio area. If I'll go there, I can't just, you know, financially and within the budgets, I can't just go for one or two people. I'm sorry, unless the Lord said, hey, go there no matter what, then I will go. But just in, you know, because lots of times we go and do in the ministry without hearing specifically. You don't have to get a word from the Lord for everything, you know. So unless the Lord specifically tells me to go, I'm only going to go unless it's, you know, at least 4, 5, 6 people to make it, what is the right word? But to be financially responsible with the budget of the ministry, brothers and sisters. So we got West Virginia, Charles Point, West Virginia, Akron, Ohio. I'm going to be coming through Nashville, Tennessee. Then going to there to Little Rock, then to Dallas. That's my lineup for right now, for the end of July and the month of August. And then Houston and Dallas and Houston, and then Baton Rouge in September, and then Seattle, Portland, Vancouver in September. Brothers and sisters, like I say, this is I know the Lord will. If the Lord wants me to go, He'll make a way. I ask you to pray in agreement with me about this. God bless you guys. You know I love you guys. And, I'm just walking by faith, brothers and sisters. That's what I've been doing for the last 14 years. And God has provided. It's just, having people to pray in agreement with you makes it much more easy. Because, the Bible says one can put 1,000 to flight, two can put 10,000 to flight. So you just multiply that. And, you know, I functioned before without just praying on my own for 3 or 4 years. And let me tell you something. Like I've mentioned before to those who've seen my videos, it's like walking in nose-deep water upstream. And then when you have a group of prayer warriors praying with you, it's like walking through ankle-deep water upstream. You know, that's the difference. So I need you guys' support and love to go forward and do this. I know the Lord keeps talking to me about giving me authority, you know, to bring revival, to take the land everywhere I go. And I know the devil's going to oppose me and stand against me. And I know that, you know, it's every day. When you're walking by faith in the ministry, I'll tell you, you can ask anybody that's in the ministry. You know, a shoe drops every day. The devil tries to drop a shoe on you every day. It's always something. One day it's a vehicle. Another day, you know, it's someone, you know, is backbiting you. Then the next day, you know, somebody's sick. And then it's just, you know, you don't have insurance. It's just on and on and on and on. But that's why, you know, it's when you hunker down and humble yourselves and be in faith and seek the Lord, that's when God gives that breakthrough. And it's a process that goes over and over and over again, to, from glory to glory, line upon line, precept upon precept, you know, to greater, to bigger and better things. You know, higher level, bigger devils. You know, the Lord gives me endless one-liners that people can remember, and it's a blessing to people. I guess that's the biggest blessing of my channel, is those one-liners that the Lord keeps giving me, like that one, you know. Higher levels, bigger devils. And that's true, brothers and sisters. That's absolutely true. You know, David killed the bear, the lion, and then Goliath. And then he even had to deal with his own son, Absalom, you know, who betrayed him because of his relationship with Bathsheba. Really, it goes back to that, to his sin. And, you know, so these are the things we have to deal with in our lives. Sometimes the Lord removes the consequences of our sin, and sometimes he doesn't, you know. We have to live with it. It's not always true. Sometimes the Lord burns our crop. The prosperity people tell you God will burn your bad crop that you sowed and give you a new crop. Sometimes he does that. Sometimes he lets you taste and reap what you've sown. And sometimes he removes it, and sometimes he uses it as a buffer, as a thorn in our flesh. It all depends. Every situation is different. God bless you guys. I'm going through all these different topics. God bless you guys. God bless you guys.